The House of the Lord and Summit County Community Partnerships, with a grant from the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services, is bringing to you Hidden in Plain Sight, Opiate Use Disorder, an Education and Awareness webinar series. In session two of this series, we will facilitate a conversation with a recovery professional about how stigmas can hinder recovery. We will have Stan Frankhart, Program Coordinator for Returning Home Ohioans and Community Transitions Program, Licking County Coalition for Housing. When you don't understand these stigmas, we can find ourselves hurting the ones we want to help. Join us on Friday, June 18th from noon to 1 p.m. via Zoom.
My name is Pastor Darren Brake with the House of the Lord, and the House of the Lord is in partnership with Summit County Community Partnerships with a grant from the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services, and we are bringing to you Hidden in Plain Sight. This is a four-part webinar series that we are doing together around opiate use disorder. Part one, we talked about kind of opiate use and how it relates to some of the effects of COVID-19 on the faith community. This week, or in this session, we're going to talk with Stan around stigmas that impact recovery. So we have Stan with us today, and Stan, why don't you just take a few minutes and tell us about yourself and how you ended up in your current role, so everyone knows, you know, who you are, and after this introduction, they will definitely understand why it was important for you to be a part of this conversation.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, it is an honor and a privilege to be here this afternoon with all of you. Pastor Darren, thank you so much for the opportunity to just share just a little bit about my walk and my journey. As Pastor Darren said, my name is Stanley Frankhart. I am 30 years old, married to an amazing wife and mother of our four-month-old daughter. It seems like she's 4 years old. She's growing like a weed. So it does definitely progress a little faster than I intended. I also have the privilege of working with those who are transitioning home from prison who have severe and persistent mental health diagnoses and substance abuse addiction. Also, individuals who have an HIV or AIDS positive diagnosis, we get the privilege to serve them as well. And I came into this position as the Community Transitions Program and Returning Home Ohioans Program Coordinator through my own personal lived experience. As a peer recovery supporter, I came from incarceration and substance abuse in myself, and I stepped into the role that I am currently in as a graduate of the very program that I now coordinate, the Community Transitions Program. And my heartbeat was to really just be able to provide advocacy, hope, and relatable services to the people who have found themselves on similar paths as myself. Ultimately, my heart jumped in because I believe in the biblical concept of redemption. What I desire to see is God use me as a tool in his hand to plant and water seeds of redemption in the lives of those who battle with substance abuse and mental illness.
Wow, that is fantastic. Just to be able to be the director of a program that you graduated from, just really shows that redemption still happens, and that people can get a fresh start and people can turn the corner. But in doing that, oftentimes there are hurdles to it. There are obstacles and things that get in the way, which also is why everyone doesn't successfully make that transition. And one of those things is stigma that people have to face. And it seems from your describing the population that you're working with, someone could actually probably have like multiple stigmas that they're trying to deal with, and they're universal, if you will, in nature. Can you talk about, you know, some of those stigmas that you see impacting people, or even how like maybe the stigma of being incarcerated impacts their recovery? So they're dealing with the stigma of recovery and incarceration, and how, you know, the stigma one can impact the other. Talk about some of your experience with people in that space.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll start off by saying first that there is a plethora of stigmas that are out there. Some of them universal, some of them more specific and demographic in nature. But one universal stigma that I have seen which impacts people's recovery is the stigma that addiction is a person's choice. And just like they choose to begin using, they can choose to stop using. The reason why I think that stigma impacts recovery is because that, you know, addiction can be compared to kind of like diabetes. Oftentimes it is a genetic or even a generational and environmental root that is planted deep within the construct of a person. And so over time, similar to diabetes, common everyday use, like common everyday, you know, ingestion of sugars creates a biological reaction that triggers the body to respond in negative ways, kind of like a diabetic reaction. And so addiction, although may be initially introduced through a person's one-time decision, it is very similar to diabetes in that the body develops kind of what we would call a dependency upon a particular substance in order for that person to function normally. This is what leads to what we like to say, the dog returning to its vomit. That's a good old proverb that we use a lot in church world. But you know, it's the body is unable to maintain normal daily functions without that substance presence. And so the person finds life more tolerable when using that substance, and they find that they're able to function a little bit more normal when that substance is present. And so just kind of like diabetes, I'm using that as an analogy to kind of help explain this whole construct of this stigma. But just like diabetes, the substance that diabetes use is insulin. And so when the body is no longer able to produce adequate amounts of insulin due to overuse of foods with high sugar content, we now know that that body needs to supplement that drain of insulin with additional insulin in order for that person to function normally. And so, you know, I think that's one stigma that, you know, when people choose to use, they choose to quit, that's something that they can do. But it's just like diabetes, that it takes a process, and that process is what we know as recovery. Along that line of some universal stigmas, I got one more. You know, I think oftentimes the challenge with addiction is that it is often co-occurring with mental health. Okay. And so people often struggle with the disease of addiction. They also struggle with mental illness. And so they're trying to self-medicate, trying to manage the symptoms of a mental illness. Sometimes they're even trying to escape the deep-rooted trauma, or simply trying to just balance out chemical imbalances that have never been addressed professionally. And so they find relief in a substance that's not prescribed and could be possibly illegal even. So I think those are some of the stigmas that impact a person's recovery, because oftentimes they feel like they are the only one who understands their addiction. And what this does is it creates a disconnect to the concept of recovery, and kind of oftentimes spirals a person back into that cycle of addiction. Again, as I said, there are many other stigmas that are present, but I do find that these are some of these universal stigmas that kind of happen. And so one that I really, really want to hone in on specifically around the concept of faith is that, this idea that once a person overcomes addiction, they should no longer battle addiction. That's a stigma that, you know, is false and stems kind of from this idea that, you know, a person struggling with addiction makes that conscious choice, like we talked about earlier. And they make that choice over and over again. Or maybe it's even to, you know, my standpoint, criminal activity. That was my addiction. I just got a rush from doing crime. And, I kept doing that over and over and over because I was looking for that adrenaline and I couldn't find it anywhere else. So I think, you know, when we do understand that addiction is a disease, it kind of helps us tear down that mental construct, and it allows room for grace for people who may relapse, but it also provides hope for redemption. Because even if someone slips or falls back into an active addiction, the ultimate end is that they are redeemable. And so expecting someone to not struggle with addiction is after going through treatment, maybe going through a rehab facility, some counseling, something of that nature, it would be like us saying that once we find God or become saved, we no longer battle with sin or temptation. That's kind of what that concept says. So,
wow, that is, I mean, you've given us so many great things as far as the choice aspect of a stigma, which I can really see that as being a almost a hidden stigma, if you will, because it's that connection where you made a choice to start, you can make a choice to quit. And then you add in the other components of mental health and the fact that the battle continues. And those type of things that really kind of give some context for someone who's has a family member that may be struggling and how they could best help them and not hurt them. And one of the things you alluded to when you started your answer was, you know, there are universal stigmas, but then there are some that are very specific, be it to someone's ethnicity and probably even their gender, that you could even dig into. So what are some, you know, maybe ethnic specific stigmas that you see impacting the people that you are trying to help on a daily basis?
Man, that's a great question. Great question. I think that one that I can think of immediately is the idea that, like, specifically within the context of the African-American family, is that, you know, African-Americans are the only people who struggle with crack addiction. I once, you know, grew up in the urban context, and that was kind of the concept that was in our community, that, like, you know, this wasn't nobody else's problem but the Black community's problem. And why I think that impacts a person's recovery of that ethnicity is because, again, it ostracizes people of color, and it isolates people of color and places it into that category of it's a them, and making it a Black community problem rather than an American people problem. Mm-hmm. You know, when a person who struggles with addiction feels ostracized or isolated, what tends to happen is that they refuse to receive help for the fear of being judged, misunderstood, or simply feeling like they're degraded. And so, you know, when they continue in their addiction and without receiving any help along the way, which could possibly lead to them dying, it could possibly lead to imprisonment, criminal behaviors, family and relational problems, and so much more. So I think that is, like, definitely one stigma that comes to mind immediately. I think some of the other stigmas that kind of birth ethnicity-wise are the stigma that, like, mental health is you know, this kind of, like, for lack of better words, this taboo. And so nobody ever wants to address mental health because, oh, that's not something that's even really relevant. And so, you know, a lot of times, like I said, addiction comes with a co-occurring, you know, mental illness. And so a lot of times we're trying to address the addiction without addressing the mental illness. And really the root of the problem is people are self-medicating via their addiction to deal with the mental illness. Statistics show that, like, there's about a 70% likelihood that somebody who struggles with addiction also struggles with mental illness. And so, you know, really being able to address the mental illness will help kind of deal with the symptom of addiction. It'll deal with the disease of addiction, because really the cycle is started because of the mental health. And so the stigma that, like, mental health is a taboo or something that we don't want to talk about, even to the extent of, like, mental health not even being a reality. Some people go to that extreme. Yet, you know, if we have that stigma, what happens is we see somebody in this repetitive cycle and we get confused thinking that, again, it's their choice and they're continuing to constantly choose to be in this cycle when really they're trying to find ways to deal with trauma. They're trying to find ways to deal with mental illness. They're trying to find how can they cope with life as it is, and so many different avenues that everyday people face. So I think the stigma of mental health being a taboo is another stigma that specifically I've seen it in the urban context in the African-American community that kind of prevents or prohibits somebody from really truly successfully recovering.
Wow. And, I mean, again, you share so much useful information. And even just in thinking about some of the comments that you made that jumped out to me, One of those is when you talked about someone using a substance to try and cope. And the people that you're trying to help on a daily basis are trying to cope with many things. When it comes to returning to society, and you know, there's mental health, there's substance abuse, like you said, there may be even HIV or AIDS diagnosis on top of that going on. So how do you help someone, or how do you deal with the coping of substance when someone is walking out a process in their life that is so prone to want someone to want to escape? Am I making sense? You know, if you're yeah. in this very difficult situation, there's so much that has just changed from, you know, being incarcerated to now being returning to society. And there's these expectations that have been placed on you. Also with all these barriers, how do you help them deal with that urge to cope or that urge to escape? How do you step in and help someone in that situation?
Absolutely. Great question. So one of the techniques that, you know, I've been blessed to be able to learn along this journey is a technique called motivational interviewing. And what the purpose of motivational interviewing is that it's designed to draw out of a person what's already in them. And so, you know, this concept that, like, you know, especially for people transitioning back home to society from prison, a lot of times they're stripped of even having a voice. They're stripped of even having a say-so in what their journey looks like. They're stripped of having a choice. And so being able to empower individuals with self-efficacy, which means, man, basically that they have a self-efficiency, they're able to do it by their own means, and in a sense of choice. When you empower somebody with that, you really set them up to buy into their own recovery. And so some of that on a practical level, what that looks like is simply asking somebody, hey, is there other ways to cope with this challenge? And a lot of times they've never even thought about that. And so as an advocate, that's where I step in to help educate of some different outlets. We try to lean into, hey, what are some things that bring you life? What do you like to do on a day-to-day basis? And some people will say, I like to work out. I like to draw. So I say, hey, how about we lean into that instead of leaning into substance abuse or even other forms of, addictive behaviors? And so, you know, being able to really draw out of somebody the fact that, one, you've already been equipped with the tools within to cope with life, but two, giving them some practical next steps on what to cope with. A lot of times I think, and I'm sharing from my own personal experience, we expect people to stop doing something, but we never replace that stopping with something else for them to do. And so, you know, with motivational interviewing, that's a huge premises on which we kind of help draw out of people what's already in them. So
can you give us an example, if you could? Are you able to give us an example of kind of how this is played out in kind of a real life scenario that you've encountered with someone? If you're able to, you know, without naming anyone or anything like that, but can you kind of give us an example of kind of how that's played out?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So I have a client currently right now who is getting ready to go back to prison for choosing to use drugs. As I use the word choosing intentionally there. She is caught up in the, cycle of addiction, and she's never really addressed that disease. She's never really asked any questions about different things. She's never even said that I deal with this or anything like that. So what I did, I visited her literally on Monday. I visited her in the county jail, and we talked about, you know, hey, do we see how kind of our decisions are affecting our lives? You know, this is something that, you know, has kind of been constant in our lives. You've chosen not to take any form of counseling. Is there any way that maybe counseling would benefit you? And naturally, you know, she said, yeah, of course, anybody who's within those confines, that they're trying to find hope. And so, you know, we provided hope in the sense of like, hey, counseling could be a very practical next step. And then, you know, asking her, what does she want out of counseling? And what she said was profound. And it seems so simple to people like you and I, but it was so profound because I've been in this situation. And she said, I just want to be able to be restored.
Wow.
And so, like, longing within the individuals who suffer with addiction, suffer from mental illness, suffer from transitioning home to prison, from prison with the barriers, the longing in them is that they want to feel restored. And so, you know, providing that next step from there was, well, what does restoration look like for you? Because it looks different for her than it does for me. Restoration for me looked like marriage and having kids and serving in my church. That's what restoration looked like for me. For her, restoration looked like being able to have her own house, even if that was an apartment. That was restoration for her because she never had that. She couch surfed her whole life, you know, dealing with friends who were, you know, caught up in addiction as well. And she said, you know, restoration to me looks like being able to have my own place to go. And so we talked about, well, here's some practical next steps. And so as a CTP and RHO coordinator, that's what we provide is housing. And so I said, well, here's some next steps that you can do. Once you, you know, get into your rhythms while incarcerated, she's got a year to do in prison. I said, once you kind of settle into that transition, sign up for what we call brief intervention program. They term that BIP. And what that is it's designed to help create a different cycle of thinking so that individuals can then recognize red flags along their journey. And what that did for her is that actually ended up setting her up to be eligible for housing through our CTP and RHO program. And now she's able to have that sense of hope and redemption that she too can be restored. So hopefully that broke it down on a practical level of what it looks like for you.
Yeah, absolutely. And the comment that she made, that you repeated was profound. It really, it made me think about something. There was an interview that I was watching with Carrie Champion. She used to be a broadcaster on ESPN, and she's since gone on and doing some other things. But during this interview, she made the statement. She said, we're all trying to find our way home. Yeah. We're all dealing with something. And in this context of our conversation with stigmas and the stigmas that we place on people, there is this, I think there's this lack of us understanding that we are all trying to find ourselves home. We're all trying to be restored in some way or another. And I think if those of us who are, you know, on the outside looking in, so to speak, of someone's struggles and someone's journey, if we are cognizant of the fact that we are all trying to find our way home, that will really help us in dealing with people and also help us to interact with them in a way that will help, that will be restorative, more so than punitive in nature. Because, you know, we're in some way, shape, or form, the context is different, but we're all seeking the same thing. Right. And as I think about that, one of the things that makes me wonder and to hear from your experience is, you know, as we talk about stigmas, a lot of them have been stigmas that are placed from the outside onto a person. But what about internal stigmas? Are there some internal stigmas that people that you're trying to help are dealing with that they are having to wrestle with as they try and, you know, embark on this journey of recovery and restoration?
Yeah, absolutely. Great question as well, Pastor Darren. I appreciate you sharing that. One of the things that I know I struggled with personally, I did 10 years in prison from the age of 16 to 26. And I remember coming home and instantly feeling like I had this big giant F right on my forehead. That like everywhere I went, everybody knew I was a felon. And so like this internal stigma that people seen me as that kind of, I would say, limited me in my willingness to do certain things. Okay. I remember a great example is I went into Walmart. No, I believe it was Myers, actually. It was Myers in Mansfield, Ohio, my first day home. And I went there because I needed some clothes. I was released and I didn't have anything but about a 20-gallon trash bag worth of things that I owned. And so my spiritual dad, he took me to Myers. And I remember walking in there and just overwhelmed. Mm-hmm. Overwhelmed that there was like, you know, I came from a setting where it was so structured, you walked on the walking path in a certain direction. Yeah. And I'm seeing families coming this way, kids running this way, other people going down the aisles this way. And then, wow. You know, once I overcame that, it was now I have such an array of choices for one item that like it was daunting to even try to hone in on one thing, because I was used to a commissary sheet where they had three choices for one item. And the way you chose what item was on that sheet you were going to purchase was by what you could afford. Exactly. And so, you know, some of those stigmas, I think, are internal, and they kind of sometimes limit someone's willingness to step out in faith. And I think, you know, I share that because so many times when we see somebody's reluctance or hesitance to kind of accept or receive help, we automatically assume they don't want the help. Yeah. We automatically assume that. And really what they're battling with is a sense of self-worth.
Yeah.
Feeling inadequate, feeling incapable, feeling unworthy. And instead of affirming somebody and saying, you are worth it. You are, you know what, I'm going to take the time to walk with you through this. We write them off as if they don't want help and never really deal with that sense of identity that they're struggling with.
So how do you kind of, does the motivational interview, what kind of pulls that to the surface?
Yeah, I to be transparent, I would say patience, number one. A lot of times I deal with a population, and myself included, where, you know, we've had to either self-educate or we're uneducated in terms of academics. And so trying to put language to things, I know for me, for the longest time, I didn't even know how to identify feelings. Like I literally had to study an emoji sheet that has kind of like those emojis on there that identify the feelings. Yeah. I studied that for 3 years to learn how to identify feelings. Wow. And so, you know, being able to be patient with somebody is a gift who is struggling with that identity, who is struggling with addiction, who's struggling with mental illness. Being patient is key. I think the second thing is really being able to draw from a personal experience. Because so many times we want to try to like separate or disconnect their experience from ours, which that doesn't leave room for compassion or empathy. I think when we give empathy and compassion, that creates relatability. And then we can kind of from that glean how that individual feels. And so from that feeling, what are some things that would affirm you? What are some things that would help somebody who is sitting on your side of your leadership draw something out of you? What type of questions would you ask? And you have to be intentional about asking open-ended questions.
Okay.
I think open-ended questions are such a gift to a person who's struggling to try to identify certain things, that once you use motivational interviewing, that kind of comes natural, because you don't want to limit somebody's responses to being so closed that it's simply yes or no. You want them to kind of muddy through and teach them how to think on their own and empower them with that self-efficacy, because they have been so limited in being able to think for themselves just by way of, you know, the prison system, just by way of, hey, this is the treatment plan that you're going to do. And once you check these boxes, you're graduated. So they've never had to really process or think through things that we on a day-to-day basis are processing and thinking through, because those decisions were already made for them. So, you know, providing those open-ended questions, again, with patience and with empathy and compassion, I think are the greatest three techniques of motivational interviewing that helps draw that out of somebody.
Wow. So to think about it, there's two more questions that I have, and I think they'll be a good way to kind of bring our conversation to a close, because this video will likely be watched by people who are either in your shoes as serving a population that's trying to make their way through recovery, or they're trying to better understand how to relate to a family member. Mm-hmm. So what are the things that some practical things that you would say to a family member of someone that is struggling with recovery and things that can help them get past those external and internal stigmas as a family member trying to walk alongside someone, and then kind of as a sub question to that question would be, if there's any one thing that you want to make sure that our audience hears you say, or any one thing you want to leave them with after, you know, giving some insight to the family role, give us that last piece of wisdom for anyone that's viewing this, that you want to make sure the audience knows about this subject matter of how stigmas impact recovery.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I appreciate that. And great question. I think one of the things that I've learned just through my personal journey that I was a recipient of from my family, practically speaking, was that, like, my family didn't try to act like they understood my journey. Wow. So many times, you know, we try to place what we think is the right solution on people. And my family gave me the room to say, you know what, Stan, you are the own expert in your own recovery. And so I want to empower you with whatever I have available, whatever resources, whatever tangibles I can give you, so that you can make your own path of recovery. And in doing that, what they did is they gave me a sense of self-worth. They let me see that, like, oh, okay, I can make decisions for myself, and people value and respect those decisions. I think that, you know, a lot of times family members, because they maybe have never experienced transitioning home from prison, maybe never experienced the disease of addiction, maybe they never experienced, you know, mental illness. I think a lot of times we try to come from a place of, this is what I was taught traditionally or what I've heard. Yeah. So it has to work because that's what I've heard. Yeah. When in all reality, it doesn't work the same for everybody. And so I think, you know, practically speaking, just giving somebody the ability to make those decisions on their own. And yes, they may end up bumping their head. They may end up stumbling. But that's where grace has to kick in. That's where mercy and forgiveness have to kick in. Because, you know, we're all broken in some form or shape, and we're all in need of restoration and redemption. I once heard a man say that, you know, had I not been given my 100th opportunity, who would have known where I had been? The Bible says it like this. The Bible says that the righteous man falleth 7 times, but the wicked end in calamity. And I think about that a lot of times, that, you know, the Bible didn't tell us that the righteous man never falls.
Exactly.
But that he got up again. Yes. And I think understanding the reality that, and this kind of segues into that subcategory, if you will, I think the understanding that everybody is redeemable.
Ah, yes.
Everybody is restorable. And nobody is ever a lost cause. Anything that we invest, any time that we put in, any energy that we exert in trying to help somebody recover is sowing an eternal seed in that person's life and in the kingdom at broad. And I think understanding that gives us the ability to do it with love, to do it with joy, to continue when it hurts, and sometimes it will, just being candid. My mother, I remember a conversation I had with my mother prior to her passing, and she said, Stan, the one thing that I always look back on my life and say is that I didn't do enough. Mm-hmm. I didn't do enough. And wow. And I share that because I think sometimes we say I'm doing too much. And sometimes that can be the case. That can be the case. You can be an enabler, and that is never what you want to be. But I think sometimes we stop from doing things because we don't want to be an enabler, when in all actuality, I would rather rest my head at night knowing that I did everything by the grace of God within me to help somebody see they were worth everything I have. And I think, man, understanding that construct and that concept comes from a place within our heart, recognizing the imago Dei, the image of God in people, and seeing that everybody inherently is worth everything because of that image of God in them. So I think, you know, that would be my just, you know, last little nugget of wisdom. Everybody's redeemable. Everybody's restorable. And don't go to bed at night regretting that you didn't give it your all trying to help somebody along that journey.
Man, those are fantastic words to end this conversation with. Once again, Stan, thank you for your time. We really appreciate you taking the time out of your day to join us for this conversation. And again, this is a partnership between the House of the Lord and Summit County Community Partnerships to bring the Hidden in Plain Sight Opiate Use Disorder webinar series. There will be two more videos coming up in this series, so be on the lookout for those via social media and things like that as we advertise for those. And at that point, Stan, once again, thank you and have a great day.
Thank you as well.
My name is Darren Brake, lead pastor of the House of the Lord, and we are excited to share with you that we are partnering with Summit County Community Partnership because of a grant made possible by the Ohio Mental Health and Addiction Services Department, and we are partnering to bring you Hidden in Plain Sight Opiate Use Disorder. This is an education and awareness webinar series. Now, I have two events that I need you to mark your calendars for. The first event is on Friday, July 9th from noon to 1 p.m. I will be facilitating a conversation via Zoom on local addiction recovery resources. I'll be talking with Perry Clark, who is the president and founder of Truly Reaching You, along with Dr. Joan Williams. She is the district outreach coordinator for the United States House of Representatives, serving the 11th Congressional District of Ohio. That means she serves Akron, Ohio. The link to register will be below in the caption. Now, the second event will happen the next day, and that is Saturday, July 10th from 11 to 2 p.m. We will have a recovery resource drive-through and food giveaway at the House of the Lord that is located at 1650 Diagonal Road in Akron, Ohio. Now, if you are connected in any way to people in need of recovery resources and their families, you need to participate in both of these events. See, these events have the potential to not only change a life, they can also save a life. Now, join us on July 9th for the webinar and July 10th for the resource drive-through and food giveaway. Looking forward to blessing the people of Akron, Ohio. Take care.